Let's listen to the words of John Calvin in his commentary on John 3:16. For God so loved the world, Christ opens up the first cause. For God so loved the world, Christ opens up the first cause and, as it were, the source of our salvation. And he does so that no doubt may remain, for our minds cannot find calm repose until we arrive at the unmerited love of God. As the whole matter of our salvation must be sought anywhere else than in Christ, so we must see whence Christ came to us and why he was offered to be our Savior. Both points are distinctly stated to us, namely, that faith in Christ brings life to all, and that Christ brought life because the Heavenly Father loves the human race and wishes that it should not perish. Computer, but or if you don't see them, remind everybody that the services are filmed and they're on, you can access them on YouTube and you can access it through our Facebook page. And if you like me and you like to hear the sermon again because it's something that resonates with you and you want to think more about, feel more on it and inspire more on it, or you hear some church news or some music that lifts you up and get you pumped for the rest of the week, always check that out and let other people know about that. And if you listen to it on YouTube, this service again, you'll know the tune for the choral introit. Thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever.
God, our Creator, freely grants us forgiveness and love. By our worship, we proclaim our trust in God.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever.
Let us worship our good and gracious God.
Our first hymn this morning is number 280, the classic Amazing Grace. We sing verses 1, 2, and 5. Together. So I'll join in our usual prayer of confession. God have mercy. We thank Jesus Christ to seek and save the lost. We confess that we have strayed from you and turned aside from your way. We are misled by pride, for we see ourselves pure when we are stained and great when we are small. We have failed to love, neglected justice, and ignored your truth. Have mercy, O God, and forgive our sins, returning us to paths of righteousness,
saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance, that Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners. He himself bore our sin in his body on the cross, that we might be dead to sin and alive to all that is good. Friends, hear and believe the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Now, friends, knowing that we have been blessed and forgiven by God, let's share a sign of Christ's peace with one another. The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Set out by the way to the Red Sea to go around the land of Edom, but the people became impatient on the way. The people spoke against God and against Moses. Why have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there's no food and no water, and we detest this miserable food. Then the Lord sent poisonous serpents among the people, and they bit the people so that many Israelites died. The people came to Moses and said, "We have sinned by speaking against the Lord and against you. Pray to the Lord to take the serpents from us." So Moses prayed for the people. And the Lord said to Moses, "Make a poisonous serpent and set it on a pole. And everyone who is bitten shall look at it and live." So Moses made a serpent of bronze and put it on a pole. And whenever a serpent bit someone, that person would look at the serpent of bronze and live. May God be thanked and praised in the reading of his holy word. Thanks be to God.
I also want to say thank you for the beautiful special music today. Thank you. So our second reading comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 3, verses 14 through 21. Now, of course, this reading includes one of the most famous pieces of scripture from the Christian Bible. I think we can agree about that. But I also wanted to share that this section of text is part of a conversation that Jesus is having with this guy named Nicodemus. And he is one of the religious leaders in Jerusalem who, at the end of the Gospel of John, ends up supporting Jesus. So this is their first conversation. But where we pick up today, Jesus is having a monologue. He's teaching. It's no longer a conversation, but that's what's happening. Jesus isn't just talking to anybody, he's talking to Nicodemus. So let's listen to the word of God for us. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who believe in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already because they have not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world and the people love darkness rather than light because their deeds were evil. For all who do evil hate the light and do not come to the light so that their deeds may not be exposed. But those who do what is true come to the light, so it may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please pray with me. Loving God, your love for us is beyond our understanding. Help us to grasp it better, God, so that we can share it with others. And may the words of our mouth, my mouth, and the meditations of all our hearts be pleasing and acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Now, I don't know about you, but John 3:16 is one of the verses I've known my whole life. I've known it so long, I don't even remember a time when I didn't know it, right? For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. That's what I have ingrained within me, right? It's instilled there. If you weren't raised in a church community, it might not have been so ingrained in you, in the fiber of your being, like it is with me, but it's very likely you've heard John 3:16 before. It's a very well-known verse. Unlike the story from Numbers we read first, right? And I think the reason this verse is so well known is because of the explosion of this verse as like the gospel verse in the late 20th century, starting around the 1970s. As the evangelical church blossomed in the U.S., so did John 3:16. As you may remember, athletes and other celebrities would have John 3:16 placed somewhere prominently to display their enthusiasm for the message. People would also have like emblazoned on t-shirts or bracelets, all kinds of things. The church I grew up in had the words painted on one of our walls in the fellowship hall. So this ubiquitous verse is incredibly comforting, right? I can see and completely understand why John 3:16 took off to a higher plane than other pithy verses that speak to God's love or grace or our salvation. The thing is, we miss so information, we pick up a verse and slap it anywhere and everywhere. This even has a name. It's called proof texting. Because it's very easy to take a verse in scripture and make it say whatever you want if you take it out of its context or where it's found. I know a youth pastor who would instill into his youth that John 3:16 was incomplete without verse 17. So he would always recite, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish but have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him." Just adding one more verse gives more context and more information to chew over. It adds the truth that Christ was sent to save the world. God came down as Jesus to bless us with eternal life and to open up this connection to the whole world. We all can have a connection with God because of Jesus. Instead of just aligning with one people group, Jewish folks, God extended the promise to save the whole world, just as God had promised to Abraham way, way, way back in Genesis. So I think we can safely say John 3:16 is one of the most famous passages from the Christian Bible. I think you all can agree with me there. Yet the story of Numbers 21, 4 through 9 is not well known to us today. It does, however, happen to be one of my favorite wacky stories in the Bible. That's how I categorize it. That's not what a biblical commentator would call it, someone who makes the big bucks writing lots of things. They wouldn't call it a wacky passage, but that's how I classify it. And it's wacky because it shows the strange ways God interacted with God's people. Plus, the book of Numbers is not a fascinating read unless for some reason you love reading lots and lots of lists and numbers, right? People like to joke that when folks decide at the beginning of the new year, "I'm going to read the Bible from front to back, all of it. I'm going to read it this year," they get to Leviticus and Numbers and call it quits, right? They're just dope. They are not entertaining reads, but Numbers has this little bit of sprinkling of random stories and some nice narrative and not just lists like the story we read today. So in this story, the people, the Israelites, are complaining again about their ways, the way their lives have been since leaving Egypt. Let me just tell you, they complain a lot. And God is apparently fed up with this business. And so God wants to teach them a lesson they won't forget. God sends in snakes that end up killing a number of people in the camp. The people realize their wrongdoing and how their complaints brought on this negative consequence. They beg Moses to act on their behalf. And so Moses, like he always does, steps in to deflect the blame. God heeds Moses and provides him with an antidote. "Have the people who are bitten by the snakes look up to the bronze snake to be healed from the venom of the real snake." And amazingly, this works. This remedy that really shouldn't work does work. And when you compare that to today and this journey with COVID-19 and the vaccine, we're also seeing amazing results that wouldn't have been expected 2 years before. Never before has a vaccine been so quickly created and tested and studied and approved. It's a miracle in and of itself that we have access to not just one, but three vaccines in the span of a year, right? Because the pandemic began on March 11th and we already have three vaccines. That's a miracle. And yes, this year has not at all been ideal. Oh, we've made it through. Thanks be to God, right? We're now in the start of our second year living with COVID. And this year, we might be able to live our lives a little bit more like what we experienced pre-2020, aka the before times, as people on the internet like to say. Now, there are any promises made about the speed to which we can meet in large gatherings, or travel around the world, or see family we've been missing and haven't been able to see in a year. But we can feel that the time is coming when things will be more accessible again. We have promising vaccines that help mitigate and lessen the risk the virus provides. Just like for the ancient Israelites wandering around the desert for an entire generation, this bronze snake was their assurance that they could leave their tents and interact with the world outside them. The brilliant thing about the bronze serpent is that to heal the people who were bitten, they had to humble themselves and lift their eyes up away from their affliction and up toward God. They had to release any hold they had in their own power or strength to find the relief of God's amazing power in the miracle antidote of the bronze serpent. Jesus knew this story. That's why he refers to it in the first verse of our passage today. He knew he'd act as the bronze serpent for all of humanity. He'd be the antidote we need to have life, and not just any life, but eternal life. His standing in and taking on flesh and the burdens of our sin, the very thing separating us from God, created the space for our lives to be made complete and whole, embraced by God's love. We have to humble ourselves to look up at him hanging there on the cross. We have to humble ourselves and see how much we truly need him, to grasp his sacrifice for us and on our behalf. Dr. Alicia Myers, a professor of New Testament and Greek at a divinity school in North Carolina, encapsulates this when she writes, quote, "In order to receive this gift, that is eternal life, however, humanity must acknowledge its need by looking to Jesus. This larger context also helps us understand the allusion to Numbers 21 in John 3:14. In Numbers 21, the Israelites grumble against God's wilderness provisions. To reveal their mistake, the Lord sends poisonous serpents who bite and kill many Israelites. When they cry out to Moses for intercession, God's prescription is a mounted serpent set up in the camp. To experience healing, the Israelites must look to the serpent raised above them. That is, they must see the image of their sin and acknowledge their wrongdoing in order to accept God's gift of life. Like this serpent, Jesus' mission to the world is one of revelation. But, as in Numbers, his arrival is a mixture of rescue and punishment. Jesus' arrival can lead one out of darkness and into light and life. Or it can confirm one's place among the dead." End quote. Professor Myers is bringing together the connection Jesus himself makes with Numbers 21 and a major theme in the Gospel of John, the dualistic dynamic between light and dark. By this, the author of John is trying to separate between things from God and things not from God, where the dark reflects the sin and the separation from God that's in and with all of us. Jesus is having this conversation with a well-educated man, Nicodemus, right? Who comes to him in the middle of the night, in the shroud of darkness, to learn from Jesus. Nicodemus wants his appreciation of Jesus to be hidden from the other religious leaders. And Jesus knows when Nicodemus comes in the middle of the night to talk with him. Jesus gladly talks to him, even when Nicodemus doesn't understand what Jesus is saying. They dialogue for several verses before Jesus begins this monologue, which we read, right? Jesus wants Nicodemus to see his true power, not just that of a teacher, but of so much more. Jesus wants to explain to this very devout person the expansiveness of God to embrace more than traditionally thought. Now, here's just a little brief aside. An unfortunate reality with the Gospel of John is how it has been used in very anti-Semitic ways for millennia. These repercussions are still seen today. And to me, that is a deep, deep shame. Because John 3:16 through 17 shows the expansive power of God's love. Jesus was a Jewish man, and his disciples were Jewish people too. They didn't forsake their religion. They opened it up for all of us to see and know the true God of the universe. Jesus hung on the cross. He was lifted up in a brutal way to release us from our separation from our Creator. Our R today is relief, because Jesus wants to be our relief. He wants us to humble ourselves, acknowledge our need for Him, and to release whatever is holding us down or back. Maybe for you it's the fear of the unknown. Maybe it's a secret shame about an event in your past that you can't shake. Maybe it's a grudge you just can't let go of. You know what's weighing you down, and Christ is your bronze serpent, the antidote to our burdens that build up walls and keep us from embracing God's love. Because God's love for you is massive and is freely given. Whatever it is you're trapped in, God already knows it, and God is already holding it. It's now the time to let it go, as Elsa would say. Of course, that's easier said than done, right? It does take a lot of prayer and self-evaluation to fully remove the weight of whatever it is that's on your conscience. For me, it's a grudge I have for my drama teacher who didn't cast me as the lead in the last musical of my high school career. That sadness and bitterness is still inside of me. And I know Jesus doesn't want me holding on to that hurt and anger and bitterness. And I pray for a change of heart and a release of these feelings that my heart frankly doesn't want to give up. It's comfortable there, you know. I know it'll come, and I trust that when it does, the relief will feel complete. I'm guessing, which I know isn't the best thing to do, that you have something that's still dwelling within you that doesn't help you grow as a loving follower of Jesus. And He wants you to feel the relief only He can provide. This won't necessarily be a quick solve, but knowing God's faithfulness and never-ending love, we can trust our relief will come, perhaps we least expect. In the meantime, it doesn't hurt, to practice forgiving yourself and or the other person and praying for a softening of your heart or mind or spirit. Just as the ancient Israelites had to be active participants in their healing from the serpent bites, we need to be active participants in walking along Jesus' healing power and God's amazing love for the world, especially for you. So friends, release your burden and find relief in Jesus. Amen. friends, it's now a very exciting part of our service where I will like to invite all the people who need to be installed today, as well as Mr. Charlie Bates, to come forward to the chancel. Thank you, everybody. We also have some leaders on Zoom. So we know you're there too. Thanks for being here.
So how about you just kind of go over here? Sarah, how about you step up higher level? There we go. Just try to keep some space between ourselves.
Thank you, everybody.
Hey, you can unmute your mask.
Great, everybody has their piece of paper. So this is a special day in our church because it's the time where we're going to install, everyone has been ordained already. So we're just going to install our leaders into leadership officially. The way the Presbyterian system works is that we elect leaders, which we did last week, to a term to serve on our behalf, on your behalf. Our elders make all the decisions. Believe me, if we didn't have elders, we'd have a whole lot more congregational meetings. And nobody wants that, right? So you happily designate that duty to your elders, who meet almost monthly for session. And then we have our deacons, who are the caring members, leaders of our congregation. And so they're the ones who are constantly praying for all of you. And when you're sick, they might go visit you or bring things to you. They also help make sure that we're always giving to other organizations in the area. Just a little snapshot of what our elders and deacons do. Now, we see these beautiful people here, and there's some people on Zoom. There is at least one person who we voted on last week who is not able to be here. So we will install whoever isn't here at a future period of time, because that's allowed. That's totally fine. People can start their ministry, their leadership, before they're installed. It still works. We'll just catch them up another time. In fact, there's people up here who are even serving but haven't been installed because what is 2020, right? And so we're kind of doing some catch up today as well, because there's more faces than who we voted on last week. So with that, I would invite Charlie Bates to introduce our members for leadership to be installed today.
As your clerk to session, the session installs to active service those previously ordained: Deacons Cheryl Deckmar, Frank Del Sardo Sr., Phil Harden, and Janet Hazler, and elders Richard L. Hazler, Jason Tao, and Ashley Sicard.
Thank you, Charlie. Every time we come together to do kind of like a rite of passage, we also want to remember the baptismal covenant that is made on our behalf if we're children or little babies, and the covenant the church makes with the individual being baptized. So that's why I moved to the font. That's a fancy name for that thing next to Charlie. That's our baptismal font. So it's just important to remember that with our baptism, we are confirmed as members of our church family, fully embraced by God's love, right? And so baptism doesn't change the fact that we're loved by God, but it does remind us and bring us into the faith community. And so as we have leaders who will lead us in our faith community, we just want to remember the vows that were made on our behalf to nurture us, to walk with us, to grow in faith together. And that's what our leaders are doing. They are stepping into those baptismal covenants so that all of us can continually embrace them. So remember your baptism. Remember how loved you are and that you are part of a community. So now, as we remember this, we want to affirm our faith. And today we'll be using the words of the Apostles' Creed. It is in your bulletin. And for this, we want to stand. So if you are seated, please rise and join in our affirmation of faith to the Apostles' Creed. Sorry, folks, if your identity didn't finish. So do your best. Okay, here we go.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, the only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty, from whence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Thanks, everybody. You can sit back down again. A little bit of aerobics, I know. It's good for the heart. Okay, so now that we've affirmed our faith, remember our baptism, I now have questions to ask to the deacons and the ruling elders. That's why they have this pink sheet of paper. The questions are long. So here we go. And just so you know, Zoom folks, you will have a chance to say the words first and then the people out there. Okay, here we go. So, elders and deacons, these questions are the same. Do you trust in Jesus Christ, your Savior, acknowledge him Lord of all and head of the church, and through him believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? Do you, on Zoom? They might be, you have to mute yourself probably.
We do.
I heard at least one affirmation. Okay.
Yes, we do.
There we go. Do you?
I do.
Do you accept the scriptures of the Old and New Testaments to be, by the Holy Spirit, the unique and authoritative witness to Jesus Christ in the church, universal, and God's word to you? Do you on Zoom?
We do.
We do.
We do.
We do.
I do.
Do you sincerely receive and adopt the essential tenets of the Reformed faith as expressed in the confessions of our church as authentic and reliable expositions of what Scripture leads us to believe and do? And will you be instructed and led by those confessions as you lead the people of God? Zoom, if so, say I do.
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 Will you, change of word here, will you fulfill your ministry in obedience to Jesus Christ under the authority of Scripture and be continually guided by our confessions? Zoom people, will you?
We will.
We do.
We will.
And folks in sanctuary?
I will.
Will you be governed by our church's polity? And will you abide by its discipline? Will you be a friend among your colleagues in ministry, working with them, subject to the ordering of God's word and spirit? Zoom people, will you?
Do.
Sounds like they will. Okay, sanctuary folks.
I will.
With God's help.
Will you?
Will.
Thank you. Will you, in your own life, seek to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, love your neighbors, and work for the reconciliation of the world? Zoom folks, will you?
We will.
Good job. Sanctuary people?
I will with God's help.
Do you promise to further the peace, unity, and purity of the church? Zoom folks, do you?
We do.
We do.
Sanctuary folks?
I do.
Will you pray for and seek to serve the people with energy, intelligence, imagination, and love? Zoom folks, will you?
We will.
We will.
Sanctuary folks?
I will with God's help.
Now, this is important. This question is for deacons only. Will you be a faithful deacon, teaching charity, urging concern, and directing the people's help to the friendless and those in need? And in your ministry, will you try to show the love
and justice of Jesus Christ. Deacons on Zoom, will you?
I don't know who the deacon is on Zoom.
You remember if you're a deacon? Oh, well, I'm going to guess they said I will. Okay, and now ruling elders. Will you be a faithful ruling elder, watching over the people, providing for their worship, nurture, and service? Will you share in the government and discipline, serving in the councils of the church, and in your ministry, will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ?
I will, with God's help.
We will.
Oh, I didn't hear you, thank you. Okay, thank you so much. And here's a little fun fact for you. All of those questions are the same questions I answered when I became ordained, except the last one, because the last questions are individual for the different leaders of the church. So that's just a little fun fact for your Sunday. So with these in mind, it's now time for you all to answer questions, right? So we're at the constitutional questions for the coronation, and Mike will be leading those for us today.
Do we, the members of the church, accept Cheryl, Frank, Phil, Janet, Richard, Jason, and Ashley as the deacons and elders chosen by God through his voice, chosen by God through the voice of this congregation to lead us in the way of Jesus Christ? Please respond, we do. Do we agree to encourage them to respect their decision, to follow as they guide us, serving Jesus Christ, who alone is the head of the church?
Yay, okay. So now that we have officially answered all the questions, the next step is the laying on of hands. But due to COVID, we're not going to physically stand and touch one another. Not so safe right now. So what I'd like to do, if you have been ordained to any form of leadership in the Presbyterian Church, USA, I'd like you to stand and then hold out your hand, right? Towards the folks up here. And if you're on Zoom, you can hold your hand up to the camera so the people on Zoom know that they are being blessed as well. With this in mind, please pray with me. Oh God, we are so grateful for these folks who are willing to say yes to serve you and your people in this special way. Guide their hearts. Help them to embrace whatever you have in store.
We know, O Lord,
that you will guide us through all that we do by the power of your Holy Spirit. Bless us and keep us, and we pray for our leaders that they may be filled and jubilant in their new ministries. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. We are very happy to declare that we have now installed officially several different classes of elders and deacons. Let's give them all a wonderful welcome. Thank you, everyone. We welcome you to your ministry that some of you have already started. Just one note I wanted to say. In the bulletin, there's the names of people who have been rotating off, and I just want to give them thanks for all their time and dedication to our congregation, because we wouldn't be Presbyterian without our leaders. So many thanks to those of you who have served and are now taking a well-deserved break.
The time of the service to share the good news and the hard news of our congregation with each other. They ask for joys and concerns. And I'm going to go to the people in the sanctuary first. And actually, I've got a joy. You know, at the start, I was saying about being able to.
God, you sat 3 hours in the salon to get your hair done.
Not my hair. saying this morning how I've gone back to YouTube and seen the church services, and that's definitely one I'm going to be checking out this week because I really needed to hear that today. And I sat here going, boy, I really want to hear this one again. So thank you, Pastor Pat. God of mercy, hear our prayer. In the sanctuary. Let's see.
Yeah, I actually have three concerns. So the Sitesma family, as some of you may have heard, there was an accident on their farm Friday afternoon in which a young man was killed. So there's a sign up for meals. Anyone that is interested in providing meals to them, you can contact me and I can check the link. So that's prayer number one for the Sitesma family. Second prayer concern is for Patty Jacobs. I think you probably heard that her daughter Kara was attacked in Philadelphia about 2 months ago. Patty was recently in a very bad car accident. So I think from our church, and in fact, I believe Patty is still maybe a member here, that we should be supplying meals to her as well. She's not able to have visitors at this point. So my plan is just to drop a meal at her doorstep. And
I can't see her.
And the third concern is my friend Heidi continues to battle breast cancer. So prayers for Heidi. I have to end with a joy, just because that's what I do. Just to continue joy that Catherine is here to lead our service and our congregation.
God, our prayer. Can the people on Zoom hear that? Yeah, thumbs.
Anyone from Zoom?
No, did they hear Betsy's?
Yes.
You
said yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Any more joys and concerns in the...
Hello.
Well, this is continue to work with my mom, Patricia. So.
The next day. There was a bad accident on a farm. Family farm in Long Beach, and I would like to ask
him, what do you think?
Oh,
it would be a lot quicker for her and a lot easier. All right, anyone from Zoom that has a word concern, please unmute yourself.
I do.
I like the color. Looks like a lot, but it really seriously isn't. Hey, Donna, go ahead.
I would like prayers for Bob.
From there.
He had glaucoma surgery.
They cannot see it. So many times when they get my hair done to go someplace, and they plaster it to my head like that, and I'm going, that's not.
I said Bob is blind in one eye after surgery, and it'll probably be a couple of weeks before he can see again.
Yay!
There was a bad, very bad farm accident in Warnish Township, and I would like to ask prayers for the three families who are involved.
I have a prayer request. It's Chris Sarno. Our son's girlfriend has COVID. And our son is being tested, so we're hoping he does not have it also. So prayers for them.
Rich Hazler.
Oh, that's nice. And now I'm going to go, are you kidding me? I look like a 12 minutes are sticking out.
Art's going in and out there. I just wanted to say thank you to everyone for their prayers. My keynote speech went great this past week.
Open up the curls.
For your thoughts and prayers.
Prayers for the Vandalen family. My cousin Jake Vandalen passed away last Monday.
Okay. Thank you everyone for sharing. Please pray with me. Beautiful God, we come to you and lay down our burdens at your feet. We know we all struggle with things that keep us tethered to earthly matters rather than heavenly ones. Help us to seek you and your kingdom first in all that we do and say. God of unchanging love, we pray for our leaders in our towns, counties, state, nation, and world. May they come to see the similarities in all of us, and may they strive to create laws that support justice, equality, and peace. May we become a world that looks after the lost, the lonely, and the oppressed, just as you desire, God. Righteous God, we don't always understand why things happen the way they do. As we pass the one-year mark of the pandemic, we pray for the people suffering from COVID. Heal those who are sick, O God, with this virus, and mend the hearts of the people who are grieving loved ones who are lost to COVID. We also lift up to you the people you've placed on our hearts and minds, including Patty Jacobs and her car accident. God, may her body find healing and may her emotions find stability in your love. We also pray for Heidi as she continues the battle with breast cancer. We know how hard that is, oh God. We continue to pray for Patricia. God, may you wrap her in your arms and may her pneumonia leave her lungs. May she breathe easy once again. We also pray for Tracy, Cheryl's daughter, and her ongoing health issues. May answers be found and may treatment begin. We also pray for the grief of the Valdolin family and the fact that Jake has left us and has gone to you. May they find healing and love in their grief. God, we also give you thanks that the glaucoma surgery on Bob went well and that he can see again. What a joy that is. We pray for the safety and the information of the unknown when it comes to Chris Sarno's son and to see whether he has COVID or not. We also pray for his girlfriend, who is a confirmed case. If they both have it, may they recover well. And if her son does not, we thank you for keeping him safe. God, we especially pray for the accident that happened at the Stitzma family farm, for the young man who died. We lift him and his family to you as they go through the unimaginable grief of losing someone so young. May the community wrap their arms around them in a figurative way, even, that they may feel supported at this time. God, and finally, we praise you for your steadfast provision, especially through the good outcome of Rich's keynote. God, we know how much preparation he put into that, so thank you for helping him to research and deliver well, and that he feels good about it after the fact. And God, we especially thank you for the ways that you speak through services, through sermons, that your Holy Spirit works through me and touches the hearts of your people. What a relief it is of your power. Holy Jesus, who delivers us from our own muck and mistakes, we thank you so much for redeeming us. We want to be your true church, your earthly body now. Guide us in all we do to have the courage, strength, and humility to declare your praise. For we know that if no one praised you, the rocks would. Help your whole church to praise you in all we do. And we thank you for the people of this church who have agreed to be leaders within it. Eternal God, you created this planet and all that's on it and in it. Help us to see this earth as a blessing and a gift directly from you, not as a tool to be used or conquered, but as a gift to provide for our needs. Use us, God, to nurture your kingdom here on earth. Remind us of our own callings and help us to release whatever is holding us back and weighing us down. Use us as your hands and feet for this week, we pray. In the strong and faithful name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray the prayer we now pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I would like to invite Rich forward for a moment for mission.
The theme for this minute for mission is because water is life. When Manuel Nazaro casts his net into the water these days, his catch is far less than plentiful. In the remote area of Bolivia near the Paraguay-Argentina border, Manuel and the members of his indigenous community are finding that fishing, their traditional livelihood, is now in severe jeopardy. The degradation of the environment and the mounting lack of access to water threatens their very survival. The one great hour of sharing helps Bolivia and the Sudan by addressing their critical water needs in those places, training technicians to dig water wells for their communities, and on maintenance, hygiene, sanitation. And in places like Detroit, our gifts have joined We the People of Detroit to secure access to water for those who have their water shut off during the pandemic. Imagine not being able to be able to wash anything during the pandemic. The One Great Hour of Sharing is the single largest way the Presbyterians come together every year to share God's love by becoming repairers of the breach, joining with people in the need to build God's house together. Together, we are making a better world for those in need, no matter where they are. Please give generously, for when we do a little, it adds up to a lot. Now, the collection for the One Great Hour of Sharing is going to be on April 4th, Easter Sunday. Please pray with me. Meet all the needs for which the world thirsts, O God. May your spring of justice, compassion, and peace spring up quickly, and may it spring up quickly in us. Amen.
Thank you, Rich, for sharing our minute for mission today. Now, one of the many ways to respond to God's word is by the giving of ourselves in many different ways, right? We return to God a portion of what God has blessed us with as a reminder that all we have is a gift from God. We give of all of our blessings, time, skills, presence, and money. They're all needed and all are a gift from God. So friends, give generously today as a sign of your thankfulness in whatever way you can. Would you please join me in our unison prayer of dedication and thanksgiving? Holy God, use our gifts and offerings to support your kingdom building work in our community. Empower us to be better caretakers and stewards of all your many blessings. In whatever form they take, We offer our gifts to you in the holy name of Jesus. Amen. Do we have any announcements or opportunities to serve today? Walt.
I wanted to say something about the Help Center. For once, instead of asking, we have special gift. We've got a woman brought in several raincoats. And so if you need a raincoat, or if you need to know anybody who needs a raincoat, please come and help yourself. I want to add, the person that gave us the raincoats is tall, so these are rather large raincoats. Okay?
So what you're saying is they want to work for me.
There's a shop.
Anybody else? Oh, Tom?
So last week we had an uptick in the views on YouTube, so we went to 49 views. But we only had 4 shares on Facebook. So there was a lot of people on Facebook. Friend request the church. When you see the link pop up, make sure you go in and share your link. Okay?
When is that
posted? By Sunday.
Sunday? Sometimes Sunday afternoon.
Yeah.
I'm going to post it to the Facebook page. So sometime Sunday afternoon. One thing I did want to note is we have not been the best at leaving the sanctuary after the benediction and post-leave. So I want to just remind us that we love to chit chat and get to see how one another is doing. But on a beautiful day like today, even though it's a little bit nippy, let's do that outside, okay? So I'll lead the charge after the postlude. I'm heading outside. And if you want to talk to me, that's where you can find me. Sound good? Yeah. Pretend a handshake. Okay. Any other announcements? Oh, Easter flowers. So next Sunday is like the deadline for Easter flowers. So make sure to get that info. Anybody else? Speak now. Hearing none, let us all stand and sing our closing hymn, Here I Am, Lord.
Thank you.
into the world, release your burdens on Christ so you may find true relief. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen.